Hello everybody and welcome back. In the introductory videos, I introduced causal variational principles as a simplification and generalization of the causal action principle. It was a simplification because we left out two of the constraints, namely the trace and the boundedness constraints. At the same time, it was a generalization because we replaced the set of linear operators curly F in the definition of causal fermion systems by a general, possibly non-compact manifold. In the introductory videos, I also derived the Euler-Lagrange equations for causal variational principles. But I did not yet explain you how to get from the causal action principle to causal variational principles. In other words, how can one treat the trace constraint and the boundedness constraint? As I already briefly mentioned in the introductory videos, this boils down to using the Lagrange multiplier method. However, the details are a bit subtle. This is why I thought that in this video we proceed as follows. We first use the Lagrange multiplier method naively and derive our results. And afterwards I will explain a little bit how to justify the Lagrange multiplier method. Okay, now what is the setting? Let me just quickly recall all this. Of course, we again have causal fermion system, HF rho, and space-time is again the support of the measure. And now we assume that rho is a minimizer of the causal action principle, and before I can explain you what this means, let me write down the causal action principle again. So we have the causal action, which is the double integral over F cross F of the causal Lagrangian. So this is the causal action. And then we want to minimize the causal action under variations of the measure rho. Under certain constraints, first of all, that the total volume is constant. Rho of F is constant. The integral of, so this is the volume constraint. The integral over the trace of X. D rho x is constant, the trace constraint, and finally that the functional, let me denote it by capital T, which is the integral over F cross F of the spectral rate of x, y, squared, that this is smaller than a constant capital C. This is the boundedness constraint. Good. This is the causal action principle. Here I should have written smaller or equal to C. The next question is like, what does it mean for a measure rho to be a minimizer? And this depends on the setting which we are in. Let us begin with a finite dimensional setting. So if the dimension of H is finite, well then we can also choose the total volume to be finite. Rho of F is finite. Well, in this case, there are measures for which also the trace constraint here is satisfied, and this boundedness constraint is satisfied for a given choice of the constants, non-negative, non-zero strictly positive constants. Okay, and then one can minimize in the class of all regular Borel measures. Of all regular Borel measures. On curly F. So in this setting, everything is well defined. The action is finite. One can minimize it. And this is also the setting where Nye's existence theory has been developed, which will come later in this course. I think it's better before just proving abstract existence that one understands a little bit, well, what do the Euler-Lagrange equation mean? What does it mean to be a minimizer? And all of that. This is why we do this first. Okay, so this is the finite dimensional setting. Unfortunately, this is not sufficient for at least some of our applications. Namely, suppose you want to describe Minkowski space, then the total volume is infinite, and therefore this doesn't fit. And this leads one to at least have in mind that there is also the infinite dimensional setting. Well, in this case, we also choose the total volume to be infinite. And then there's a problem with this causal action principle because everything is infinite. First of all, I mean the total volume. This is what I just said. So this constant here is infinite. The causal action will typically be infinite, the boundedness constraint as well. There's no reason why this integral over the trace should be finite. So this means that all the quantities coming up here are ill-defined. Nevertheless, one can make sense of the statement rho is a minimizer, but one has to make sure that when varying the measure, that then all these quantities here change only by a finite amount. Let me specify how this can be done, and let us assume, just for technical simplicity, that our measure rho is, again, a bounded irregular Borel measure. This is again a regular Borel measure. Of course, not bounded anymore. And that it is locally finite. This is again a regular Borel measure, which is locally finite. So what does locally finite mean? So this means that the volume of any compact set is finite. Rho of K is finite for all K contained in F compact. Now we consider variations which leave the measure unchanged outside a compact set of space-time. So therefore let K, the subset of space-time, be compact. And now we consider a variation, so this means a family of regular Borel measures, say tau is in 0 delta, with, well, first of all, rho 0 should of course be our measure rho, and rho tau restricted to m minus k, so this means outside this compact set k, should be the same as rho restricted to m minus k. Okay, so in other words, the measure, only the part of the measure supported inside k is changed by the variation. And as a consequence, one can make mathematical sense of the differences of the corresponding functionals here. Let me explain this first for the volume constraint. How can we now make sense of the volume constraint? And of course, the first thing, well, the naive approach would be just to write the difference of the total volumes before and after. So rho tau of F minus rho of F. This should be zero. But of course, this doesn't make sense because both terms here are infinite. And well, before drawing any further conclusions, let's write this out a bit nicer. So we decompose this measure rho tau of F into the measure of M minus K plus the measure of F minus M minus K. Well, and then we have, of course, the measure rho of M minus K plus the measure rho of K. And now the problematic terms are these two terms because they are infinite. But on the other hand, using that the measure remains unchanged there, these two terms are the same. So therefore, we could just cancel them out. So just formally, we can disregard them. And now we have a new equation which makes mathematical sense because now everything is finite. Of course, there's a minus sign here. And therefore, we can, this makes it possible to formulate the volume constraint as rho of F minus M minus K should be equal to rho of K, also left side rho tau, for all tau. Okay, so in this way we have made sense of the volume constraint, even if we have an infinite total volume. And in fact, it turns out that if one looks at now the differences of the trace constraint, differences of boundedness constraint, difference of causal actions, then they are also mathematically well defined. And then we can say, well, it's a minimizer if for all such variations, the causal action can only get larger. So let me write this. Then we can say rho is a minimizer if for all such variations, which satisfy the constraints, the difference, so S of rho tau minus S of rho is bigger or equal to zero for all tau. And again, this difference here is mathematically well defined. Maybe I should also remark, well, what does it mean here, boundedness constraint? This is an inequality. How can you preserve an inequality? For example, what one can do, one considers variations which do not increase t. And in this way, one has built in the boundedness constraint. Okay. So this is what a minimizer is. The question is, of course, what are the Euler-Lagrange equations? And well, we want to proceed step by step and first get information on the local trace, because this makes it possible to treat the trace constraint. Okay. But as I said, we want to proceed in a more computational way. Computational procedure. So we consider Lagrange multipliers. This means we write down an effective action S, which depends on three Lagrange parameters, kappa, lambda, and mu. Well, which is the causal action, plus kappa times t minus a certain constant, minus lambda times, well, here's then the integral over the trace, They said this trace of x is also referred to as the local trace because it's a trace of the spacetime point operator at the spacetime point x, d rho x minus a constant c2, and then minus mu times rho of f minus a constant c3. So this is just a naive Lagrange multiplier method. So we add multiples of the constraints with certain prefactors, which are our Lagrange multipliers. And then the Lagrange multiplier method states that the minimizer under the constraints is a critical point of this effective action, where we also allow to vary kappa, lambda, and mu. Okay, now first of all, it's good to write this out in a somewhat nicer way. Namely, we have first of all the terms which are double integrals over space-time, so f d rho x, f d rho y, and then we write here l of xy plus kappa times the spectral weight of x times y squared. So, okay, and then we have this term minus lambda times the integral over the trace of x, d rho x, and then minus mu times rho of f. And then, of course, we have the three constant c1, c2, c3. I mean, I write down these terms, although they will be of no relevance because they remain fixed under the variations. So this means we have here minus kappa c, c1 plus lambda c2 plus mu times c3. So therefore, this is an irrelevant constant here. And I should say that this combination here, this is also what I denote by L sub kappa. So the effective Lagrangian, which also where the boundedness constraint is built in. Good. I should say that here again, the integrals do not need to converge. So this means in order to make sense of variations, we need to consider again variations which leave everything outside a compact set fixed. And let's do this now. And also we consider a specific class, namely which are also introduced in the introductory video already, namely where we multiply rho by weight function and then we take a push forward. So this means what we do is we choose f tau. So this is now a function or in space-time, which is say strictly positive, and then we choose f tau. So this is a mapping from M to curly F, and we assume that everything is smooth in tau. Well, in here smooth means, well, these are linear operators. So this all takes place in, well, this F tau of X. So this is in the Banach space here. And that's what we mean by smoothness here. Okay, it's not really so important here what it means to be smooth. I mean, it's just the computational part anyhow, where we just compute things and we don't really worry much about whether all this really makes mathematical sense, because this comes later. Okay, then we consider a family rho tau, which is then the push forward of f tau times rho. So this is our variations. our variation. And now we have to plug in or impose that everything is unchanged outside a compact set. So what do we assume? So first of all, we assume that f0 is the function constant 1 on M. F0 is the identity. Let's see, f0, let's write it like that. F0 of x is equal to x for all x in M. And next we assume that f tau restricted to m minus k is equal to 1, and f tau on m minus k is the identity. Okay. And for such variations, kind of the change of the effective action is well defined. Good, and now let me state the theorem. Under the above assumptions, for a minimizing measure, rho, the local trace is constant. That is, the trace of x is equal to a certain constant, that's just denoted by C, for all x in M. Good, let me now prove this theorem, and in preparation it might be good to explain you how to work with the push-forward measure. Suppose we integrate a certain function, it's denoted by phi, for example, a continuous compactly supported function on curly f. And now we integrate phi of x over d rho tau of x. How can this be rewritten? Well, I mean, the push-forward measure is defined by, we take the measure of the pre-image. Then if one does this, first of all, for step functions and then one approximates, then one finds that this is the same as phi of f of x, and now, but now we integrate with respect to f tau rho. Let's just write it like this, or f tau, let's write the product right away. F tau of x, d rho x, and of course there should be also an index tau here. So this is, by definition of the push-forward measure, or more precisely, one also needs to use an approximation argument. So this is just the definition of push forward. Plus approximation argument. Or say for whatever, for a step function, it is obvious, and then you approximate this with pointwise convergence and so on. So let me not go into this here. Now we make a specific choice for capital F tau of x, namely we choose F tau of x as x over the square root of little f tau of x. The reason for this choice is that as a consequence, the action and the boundedness constraint remain unchanged. Let's see how this comes about. Suppose we integrate the causal Lagrangian over one of the arguments, d rho y, with respect to the varied measure, d rho tau of y. And we only want to integrate over the region where the measure changes. This is why we integrate here over f minus m minus k. Then, by definition of the push-forward measure, or while using this relation which we derived, we can write this as the integral over k l of x comma y. So then y is, by definition of the push-forward measure, first of all, we write here f tau of y times little f tau of y d rho y. Now we can put in our ansatz for capital F tau of y, then we get the integral over k l of x comma y over square root of f tau of y times little f tau of y d rho y. And now we can use that the Lagrangian is homogeneous of degree 2 in each of the arguments. So therefore, this is the same as the integral over k l of x comma y, and then we get a factor 1 over square root of f tau of y squared times f tau of y d rho y. And as I said here, I use that l of x comma dot is homogeneous of degree 2. Good, and now one sees that all these factors here cancel out. This is just what we wanted. This also explains our ansatz here. So we took here 1 over the square root with the purpose that when taking out this factor of the Lagrangian and gets squared, it cancels the change of the measure with this little f tau of y here. So therefore what we get here is the integral over k l of x comma y d rho y, and this is independent of tau. Okay, now if you integrate over the other argument, over x, it's the same method applies. So therefore what we conclude is that the action, and well, it's the same argument for the boundedness constraint because it has the same homogeneity, they do not depend on tau. So therefore, if we consider, well, how does the effective action change? But let's just quickly go back. So here's the effective action. Well, then this part here is unchanged. Of course, also the constants here drop out. The only terms to keep in mind are these two terms. So they do change. And let's write this out in detail. So therefore, if we now take the effective Lagrangian, which depended on parameters kappa lambda mu of rho tau of the varied measure minus s kappa lambda mu of rho, then we only need to take into account the term involving the trace constraint. So this is minus lambda times the integral over k, because outside of k nothing changes. Then we have here the trace of f tau of x times f tau of x d rho x. Well, and then we have minus mu times the integral over k f tau of x d rho x. And then of course we have to subtract the corresponding terms of the unperturbed measure, which is here integral over k trace of x d rho x, and then here minus mu times, well, simply rho of k. Good, so now we can again put in the specific form of f tau, And we can use that the trace is homogeneous of degree 1. So therefore, if we take this 1 over, so we can get this 1 over square root of f tau in here. But now when it goes out, the factor square root of f tau remains. So therefore, we can also write it like this. Minus lambda times the integral over k square root of f tau of x minus 1 d rho x minus mu times the integral f tau of x minus 1 d rho x. Okay, now we consider first variation, and in order to keep things as simple as possible, let's just choose f tau of x as 1 plus tau times a function g of x. For sufficiently small tau, and g should be a bounded function, now we can compute the derivative. So then it follows that d by d tau s kappa lambda mu of rho tau at tau equal to 0. In other words, the first variation of the effective action is given by, well, and now we simply differentiate this here with respect to tau at tau equal to 0. And then we get, so differentiating the square root, we get a 1/2. So we get minus lambda over 2 integral over kappa g of x d rho x minus mu times, well, and here we simply get g of x times d rho of x. Oh, I forgot something. Of course, I forgot the trace of x. Sorry, this is of course important. Let me insert this here. So here there's of course the factor trace of x. And similarly here. Good, and now we can simplify all of this to one integral. So then we have here minus lambda over 2 times the trace of x minus mu times g of x d rho x. Okay, and if you have a minimizing measure, then the first variation vanishes. Because rho is a minimizer. So therefore, this integral vanishes, and we are still free to choose g arbitrarily. Since g is arbitrary, so we can use a denseness argument to conclude that the other factor has to be zero almost everywhere. It follows that the trace of x is indeed constant. Namely that whatever trace of x is equal to 2 minus 2 mu over lambda almost everywhere, or could also say on the support of the measure rho. And this is precisely what we wanted to show. Well, the trace is a continuous function, so therefore if it's continuous, if it's constant almost everywhere, it is in fact constant on all of the support. Okay, so this concludes the proof of this theorem. Well, and as I already pointed out, I was sloppy because I used the Lagrange multiplier method just naively. I just wrote down here an effective action involving 3 Lagrange parameters. Can one really do this? How can one justify this? And there are basically 2 methods for justifying this. in order to justify Lagrange parameters or the Lagrange multiplier method . So there are two methods. So the first is to do infinite dimensional analysis. On the Banach space, on a Banach space of measures. Let me just quickly outline how this goes. On the Banach space, and what one takes here is all the signed measures, so mu signed measure on curly F, or say signed Borel measures on signed regular Borel measure on curly F with the property that the total variation is finite. Well, depending on how you define signed measures, this is automatic. But let's point this out for clarity. So the total variation of all the measures is finite, and then the norm of a measure is simply the total variation. Okay, then one has a Banach space, and then one can adapt the usual proof of the Lagrange multiplier method to this infinite dimensional setting. This is something I did in detail together with Jan Bernard, who is now at Monash University in Australia, in Melbourne. And I don't want to enter the details here. So this is one possibility, but it takes some technical effort, and one gets the Lagrange multiplier method provided that certain conditions hold, which we worked out. And I should say that for the boundedness constraint, there is no other way. I mean, this is necessarily for the boundedness constraint, this is the only method. At least the only method I'm aware of. This seems to be the only method. But then you see the details in the paper with Jan Bernard, you find a link on our website. The second method, which works only for the trace constraint and the volume constraint, what one can do is one can arrange the constraints by hand by a rescaling procedure. And I want to conclude this video by explaining you a little bit how this goes. However, for simplicity, we restrict attention to the case that the total volume is finite. Good, so what is the setting here? So we assume that the total volume is finite. Say rho of, well, and then if it is finite, we can arrange it that it's equal to 1. And we consider a variation as before. So this means we have a rho tau, which is capital F tau star of little f tau times rho. A variation as considered above. This variation does not satisfy the volume and boundedness constraints. Namely, if we consider the integral over, well, now let's integrate over all of f, everything is finite anyhow, the integral d rho tau is the same as the integral over f, f tau d rho. Well, and this won't be equal to 1 in general. This means the volume constraint is not satisfied. And what about the trace constraint? Trace of x, d rho tau of x, where this is the same as the integral over f, trace of f tau of x times little f tau of x, d rho of x. So therefore, this is also not equal to the integral over trace of x, d rho x in general. Okay, what we do now is that we rescale the measure and we also change the support of the measure, and we do it in such a way that the volume and trace constraints are satisfied. So this means we do the following. Now introduce a new variation described by little f tau tilde and capital F tau tilde with, okay, now let's see how we do this. So first of all, what is the f tilde tau, well, of x? Well, this is the f tau of x, but now we rescale it, namely we multiply it by 1 over the integral over f, f tau d rho. And the capital f tau of x, this is f tau of x, and then we multiply this by a certain prefactor, namely we multiply it by the trace of f of x, sorry, no, trace of x, and we should better write here y, so we multiply by the integral of trace of y d rho y divided by the integral of the trace of f tilde tau of y times f tau of y d rho y. Maybe I need a little bit more space here. Times f tau of x. Okay, what's the point of doing this? Well, here we have a certain constant, here we have another constant. There's a constant which just depends on tau, of course, just a constant function in on curly f. And by doing so, we have arranged that if we now integrate the f tilde tau over d rho, so if we here we put a tilde, then we get 1 just by construction. If similarly here we put tildes, then we also get the unchanged guy. So this, using this rescaling and using that the constraints here are linear, one can easily satisfy the constraints by, well, changing the total volume and by rescaling the operators. Good. Then, what do we get? And now we did the trace and volume constraints are satisfied. thus the volume and trace constraints are respected, and therefore we can now simply compute zero is the first variation of, well, and then here we have only to write s plus kappa t at tau equal to zero. And I should of course maybe have written for clarity s of rho tilde tau plus kappa times t of rho tilde tau at tau equal to zero. This is now zero. So we can leave out the volume and trace constraint because they are satisfied anyhow. Well, and now one has to compute all this. And then one finds that these kind of rescaling factors here, of course, they also need to be differentiated, and they give precisely to the Lagrange multiplier terms. So maybe we write it like this, just symbolically. This is the same as if I had taken the variation of S of the unrescaled measure, so no tilde here, plus kappa t of rho tau at tau equal to zero, plus Lagrange multiplier terms. Okay, it would probably be boring to compute all this in detail. Of course, this might be a good exercise for you. But I think this is like a good point to stop. I hope that you understood how one can derive that the local trace is always constant. And this is quite useful for simplifying the setting. And this is what I will explain in the next video. Okay, hope to see you again soon. Bye-bye.